Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. It's good to be in the house of the Lord once again. Let's open our Bibles to Psalm 101. Psalms 101. Psalms 101. I'll take the odd numbers and then we'll take the even one. So I'll start with verse 1. Are we ready? I will sing of mercy and judgment unto thee, O Lord, will I sing. I will set no wicked thing before mine eyes. I hate the work of them that turn aside. It shall not cleave to me. Whoso privily slandereth in his neighbor, slandereth his neighbor, him will I cut off. Him that hath an high look and a proud heart will not I suffer. He that walketh deceit shall not dwell within my house. He that telleth lies shall not tarry in my sight. I will wholly destroy all the wicked of the land, that I may cut off all the wicked doers from the city of the Lord. It's another day, it's another Sunday, another beautiful week. Can we go ahead and worship the name of the Lord for making it possible for us to see today? Let's thank him for the privilege to be counted among the livings today. That you can stand on your feet, you can raise your hand. It's not by your power, nor by your might. It's because God has shown us mercy. Why don't you worship him this morning? Thank God for his faithfulness. Thank him for his loving kindness. Thank him for his goodness. Thank God for his favor that he has shown you all throughout the week. Thank him. Today is the 14th day of August. He has kept you alive. There are people who started this month together and they are nowhere to be found today. It's not by your power nor by your might that you're alive. That you're able to stand in the congregation of the saints to worship God. It's a privilege. Why don't you just thank God this morning for that grace, for that privilege. Worship him. Worship him this morning. He's a good God. He's a great Father. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. In Jesus' name we've prayed. I don't know what your expectation is this morning. Why don't you just take a minute to tell God your heart desires, what you expect of him this service. He says, where two or three are gathered, he says, there he is in their midst. God is here to bless us. He's here to do you good. Why don't you tell him your heart desires? Tell him those things you want him to do for you. If you desire healing, tell God right now. If you desire deliverance, just go ahead and tell him. He says, those who come unto him, he will in no wise cast them away. God is here with us today. He will not cast you away. He's your Father. He's here to listen to us. Tell him your heart desires. Tell him what you want at the end of the service. In Jesus' name we have prayed. In Jesus' name we have prayed. Father, we thank you because you're here with us. He said, where two or three are gathered in your name, there you are in your midst. We thank you because your presence is here already. We thank you because your Shekinah presence will overflow this place and will do us good even in the service today in the name of Jesus. Father, we decree, we declare in the name of Jesus that there shall be an open heaven over us this morning in the name of Jesus. As many as our heart desires are, Father, you'll meet us all at the point of our need in the name of Jesus. Father, nobody will live here untouched by you, Lord, in Jesus' name. Every life that will step into this auditorium will live here transformed and renewed in the name of Jesus. Every sickness will be taken away from this place in the name of Jesus. Father, Lord, your people will be blessed in the name of Jesus. At the end of the service, we'll have all the reason to give you glory, because you will have done us good. You will have done great and mighty things in our lives. For in Jesus' mighty name we are prayed. Amen. Amen. Shall we open our hymn now to 227? 227. Praise him, Jesus, our blessed Redeemer.
Somebody shout hallelujah! If you know you are alive and healthy in the Lord, why not shout a great and greater and greatest hallelujah!
Hallelujah!
To the King of Kings, come and shout a great hallelujah!
Hallelujah!
Another hallelujah to the Lord, and shout a great hallelujah! Amen. Your hands. Thank you.
I want to make me lie down in green pastures. You make me wanting for nothing. You fill my hunger with honey from your sweet, sweet word. You let me worship before you.
Thank you. Atmosphere of prayer. Please let's bow down our heads and just begin to worship him this morning. In the light of the ministration that has come through the choir this morning, what do you want to tell God this morning? Do you want to praise him? Do you want to yield something unto him this morning? Just begin to talk to him now. Just worship him and speak a word unto him this morning. He is the everlasting God. He is no man. He's a God who can do what no man can do for us. So this morning, as you just come into his presence, what do you want to tell your Heavenly Father? What do you want to tell him? Just speak to him this morning. Believe him this morning that he is able to do more than we have thought or even imagined. Just begin to speak to him this morning. Believe him this morning that he is able to handle whatsoever be the issues of our lives. Believe him this morning that he is able to reach into every situation of our lives. Believe him this morning that he is able to do a new thing for you. We are going into a new week. Why not say, God, I'm believing you this week that you will do a new thing in my life. This past week might have been rough. This past week might have been full of ups and downs, but I'm believing you, oh God, as I'm stepping into this new month or this new week, you will do a new thing. You will do a new thing this month. I have been walking on a crooked road, but this new week I will walk on a straight path. There are mountains and valleys that have faced me in the past week, but I'm believing you this week, oh God, the mountains shall become level ground in the name of Jesus. Please speak to him this morning. Commit yourself unto him this morning. Believe him for something. What do you expect God to do this week? What are your expectations from God this week? Believe him. We are praying. We are already praying. We are already praying. Please pray and talk to him this morning. Pray and commit your week into the hands of God. Believe him this week that he is going to make a way for you. That the Lord is going to make a way for you. That the mountains shall become level ground. In the name of Jesus, believe him this week. That God, I am here, oh God, believing you and trusting you. That you will do a new thing in my life and in my family. You, oh God, will be exalted in every part of my life. Believe him this morning.
Oh Lord, to the hour. O kehibani eini mo fi ope emi fu oloru oloru to da hawa o
Thank you.
will you make that your prayer this morning? Will you ask God to touch your life, to touch your home, to touch your finances? Will you ask God to touch our land, Nigeria? Will you ask God to touch you somewhere? To touch you somewhere. Believe God for His touch this morning. Believe God for His touch this morning. Believe God for His touch this morning. The Lord is able to touch anyone. Just reach out your hands to Him. Believe Him this morning. Ask Him this morning for a touch. Where do you need a touch? Where do you need a touch? Where do you need a touch? Where do you need a visitation of Him this morning? Touch. Lord, touch our life. Do not leave us, O God Almighty. We have come into your presence this morning. Touch our life, O God. Touch our situation, O God. Touch our homes, O God. Touch our land, O God. Touch Nigeria, O God. Touch our children, O God. Touch our fathers, O God. Touch our mothers, O God. Touch our church, O God. Touch our finances, O God. Touch, O God. We need your touch this morning. We need your touch this morning. We cannot go, O God Almighty, from this place without your touch. Father, reach out your hands to touch us. Reach out your hands to heal us. Reach out your hands to deliver us. Lord, do something, O God. Do something, O God. We are in your presence, O God Almighty, this morning. Do not leave us to go the same way we came. Lord, remove the veil. Remove, O God, every veil upon our life. Break every shackle of the enemy. Release your favor. Release your power. Release your touch, O God. Into every life. Into every situation. Lord, we are believing you this morning. Do something new. Do something great. Do something glorious. Lord, do not allow us to leave this place the same way we came. Lord, reach out your hand and touch our life. Touch me, O God. Touch me one more time. Touch me one more time. Touch us one more time. One more touch from you, O God. Is what we need. Touch us one more time. Touch us again. Touch Nigeria again. Economy again, touch our land again, touch our life again. Do not leave us, O God. Let there be a visit from you, O God. Touch our life, O Lord, this morning. This is our outcry this morning. This is our desire this morning. O God, have your way. Have your way. Have your way, O God. Be glorified, be magnified. Just give Him thanks this morning. Just give Him thanks this morning. Give Him thanks. Give Him thanks. We believe, O God Almighty. We believe you, O God, that you have touched. You have reached out your hands into our life, into our situation. We thank you, Father. We thank you. We thank you, Lord. We thank you. Just give Him thanks. 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 Father, we thank you. Father, we bless you. Father, we magnify you. Father, we thank you, O God, for this opportunity we have to be in your presence again. We thank you, O God, because you have reached out your hands and you have touched our life. And we know, O God Almighty, that our life will never remain the same again. Lord, we believe you, O God, that as we are moving into this new week, O God, you will do a new thing. The mountains shall become level ground. The valleys shall be filled for us. The crooked road shall be made straight. Lord, those who have been afflicted, they shall be healed this week. In the name of Jesus. Lord, doors that have been shut against us, they shall open by their own accord. They shall open by their own accord. This week, as we go out in your favor. We go out in your power. We go out in your glory. In the name of Jesus. Lord, this week, O God Almighty, you will bless our food. You will bless our water. You will bless our homes. You will bless our children. You will bless our mothers. You will bless our fathers. In the name of Jesus. Lord, this week, O God, no any weapon formed against us will prosper. In the name of Jesus. We receive your favor this week. We receive your blessings this week. We receive your mighty touch this week. In the name of Jesus.
thank you, Father. We bless you, O God. We magnify you, O God. We exalt you, O God. For in Jesus' mighty name we have prayed. Hallelujah. In Jesus' mighty name we have prayed. Please let's open our Bibles to the book of Genesis, chapter 26. That is the main text for our this year in New Estate Baptist Church, our year of unusual breakthrough. Genesis chapter 26. This morning we're going to read from verse 6 and we're going to stop at verse 12. Genesis 26, beginning from verse 6. So Isaac dwelt in Gerar, and the men of the place asked him about his wife, and he said, "She is my sister," for he was afraid to say, "She is my wife," because he thought, "Lest the men of the place kill me for Rebekah, because she is beautiful to behold." Now it came to pass, when he had been there a long time, that Abimelech, the king of the Philistines, looked through the window and saw, and there was Isaac, showing endowment to Rebekah his wife. Then Abimelech called Isaac and said, "Quite obvious she is your wife. So how could you say she's my sister?" Isaac said to him, "Because I said, lest I die on account of her." And Abimelech said, "What is this you have done to us? One of the people might have brought guilt upon us." So Abimelech charged all his people, saying, "He who touches this man or his wife shall surely be put to death." Verse 12. Then Isaac sowed in the land and reaped in the same year a hundredfold, and the Lord blessed him. May the Lord bless the reading and the hearing of his word in our life in Jesus' name. We're continuing our journey of exploring the theme of the church this year, which is our year of unusual breakthrough. And the main character in this particular passage for us, we know very well, is Isaac. And over the months in the church, you know, Pastor and all the pastoral team had been examining various aspects of this man's life. We have scrutinized various aspects of his life. And having addressed, you know, some major blocks in his life, we have addressed his lack of dependence on God, which resulted in his moving away from Beer-Lahai-Roi, and then also seeing him deciding to go into an alliance with Abimelech. Today, we are looking at Isaac in the aspect that we saw him deliberately living a deceitful life. And that is why this morning the topic of our exaltation is doing the right things attracts unusual breakthrough. The key issue in today's topic for us is doing the right thing. One of the greatest moral issues that we are all struggling with today is telling the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth. We are all living in a world that celebrates wrongness. The situation has become so bad that Christians who claim to be redeemed are the ones who we find at the table of wrongness. And we thank God for the scriptures. The scripture did not hide anything about the lives of men that the scripture talks about. And so this morning, God Almighty opened to us the life of Isaac to let us see another dimension in the life of this man. But of course, the issues that are being addressed in the life of Isaac are also issues that we are all struggling with. And sometimes we ask ourselves, why will the redeemed, why will those who have a covenant with God, those who lived under the covenant of God, why will they still be struggling with this particular matter? And of course, the issues in our own context as people in Nigeria and as people even in New Estate Baptist Church, as people in Lagos, we know that many of the wrongness that is out there, by the time you investigate and you look critically at those matters, you will find believers, you will find people who are called the redeemed, you will find them at this table of wrongness. Some few months ago, we were in the banking hall, and everybody was queuing, you know, to be attended to. And a man walked in with a suit on him, and this suit had all kinds of badges. The badges of Jesus is Lord, the blood of Jesus, all the fruit of the Spirit. I was wondering what kind of a person is this. Then he had this big Bible in his hands, and then with his check or something. Everybody was queuing down, and this man, you know, just coming in, just looked and looked and looked, and, you know, all of a sudden he just left, you know, the queue and then went straight to the counter and then presented his check. Another person from another line, you know, looked at him and went and tapped him and said, "The Jesus I know will not do this one." He looked at him and said, "The Jesus that I know will not do this that you are doing. Please go back." He took another person, I don't know if this person was a Christian or not. He took that person to tell him that, "Look, you are carrying an emblem. With the Bible in your hand, you are carrying an emblem. You need to what? To do the right thing." So when we are talking about the issue of wrongness, the issue of corruption, the issue of unfaithfulness, beloved, let us not look outside. Let's look inside. That's the truth this morning. And we find Isaac, the man who was born under the covenant that God Almighty made with his father. The one whom we shall find at the table of doing everything according to the rules. We found him breaking the rules himself. And so it's a reflection. This morning is a reflection that you and I will look into the word of God and not see Isaac, but see ourselves in the reflection of the word of God. And so the matter of wrongness is a thing that we are all struggling with. Doing what is right or wrong is a matter of choice. Beloved, doing what is right or wrong is a matter of what? Of choice. A choice made during the high or the low moment shows who we are or what we really are. It is said that a person's character are revealed by the choices they make and the things they do when no one is watching them. And that's the truth. So the matter of doing the right thing or not doing the right thing is a matter of a choice. And every one of us at one point or the other, we have made certain choices that does not glorify, that does not honor God. But this morning, God is calling our attention. And God is calling our attention that if Nigeria is going to be revived, if our country is going to come back to what it ought to be, it must start from us. It must begin in his house. It must begin with me. That I must begin to look at my choices and deliberately make choices that will bring glory and bring honor to the Lord God Almighty. And so the matter of doing the right or the wrong is a matter of choice. And we need to also examine ourselves and ask ourselves critically those questions. What are those choices that I have made in the past months or in the past week that have not glorified God? And I think I need to what? I need to retrace my steps. Now, looking at the Bible text that we have read, we saw that looking at the life of Isaac from this text, we see clearly that he had issues of doing the right things. For me, the book of Genesis chapter 26 is addressing majorly the issues that Isaac was struggling with. That before God was going to release the patriarchal blessings into his life, God needed to ask Isaac and correct some things in the life of Isaac that needed to be corrected. And so the whole of the book of Genesis chapter 26, I see them in the light of God writing or addressing the issues that Isaac was struggling with, the issue of doing things the wrong way. And God said, look, you cannot lay hold of this patriarchal blessing with this kind of attitude. If you do that, then things will go wrong. And of course, we saw in the first few lines or few verses of the book of Genesis 26 that he was reckless in seeing God's hand in his situation, so he moved to Gerar. Recklessness was something that characterizes the life of Isaac. Not thinking before moving, not looking at the ramification, he just moved. Recklessness. Then we also saw he was reckless in searching for help. He went to a hidden king, Abimelech, the king of the Philistines. When he moved to Gerar, his intention was to connect to the hierarchy in the land in order to be able to get the resources of the land. That is what Isaac did. So he was reckless in his searching for help. Then we also saw Isaac. He was reckless in his speech. He denied his wife of over 40 years. Interestingly, if we look at all these things, we can see that Isaac started living a reckless life. Unconsciously, he became reckless in everything that he was doing. And if Isaac was to continue in this trend, then he was going to make a mess of the blessings that God was going to release into his hands. Beloved, there are some things that God has been withholding from us because there are certain issues in our life that are yet to be settled. There are some levels that God has not allowed you to attend to because there are certain issues in our life that we need to face and address. If not, those things cannot come. Because to give you those things is to mess up the glory that God Almighty is handing over to you. So everything that God was doing in the book of Genesis 26 was to correct the thought pattern of Isaac. And that was what we saw in verse 6. The Bible says that Isaac, in his heart, when he was responding to the question that they asked him, who is this woman? He said, she's my sister. That was half truth anyway. That was half truth. She was my sister. Why? Because he thought, lest the men of this place kill me because of Rebecca. That's a serious matter. Just imagine Rebecca standing on one side, Isaac on one side, Abimelech on the other side. And Isaac and the king or the people asking Isaac, Baba Isaac, because at this time he was not a young man. Baba Isaac, who is this fine lady that is always going about with you? Oh, this one, she's my sister. In fact, the reason I'm bringing her along or she's following is because she knows how to cook very well. And so she's helping me to take care of things. And just imagine Rebecca standing there and thinking inside her, hey, so I'm your sister now. After two children, Abby. After Jacob. After Esau, I'm your sister. Okay. She didn't say anything. And Isaac, in his deceit, thinking that he was deceiving the king, or even deceiving himself, thought he could get away with what he did. But we thank God for Rebecca. I can imagine if Rebecca was an ungodly woman. As he was saying that, this is my sister. Hey, thank you. It's now that you tell me that I'm your sister. Hey, excuse me, I am his wife. Right there, she will have broken the whole thing. But you see, sometimes, I think for our women, it's a big lesson that it's not all things that you respond to outside. You know, many, many relationships, many homes have been damaged because you responded at the inappropriate time. There's always a time to respond. Rebecca used godly wisdom not to have responded, because I'm sure that Rebecca heard when Isaac said, she's my sister. And she never said anything. No wonder 1 Corinthians chapter 13 says that love bears all things sometimes. The reason why many homes today is still having issues is because you are not able to comport yourself in the place of bearing many things. I'm not saying what Isaac did was right. I'm not saying Isaac was doing what was right. But, you know, two wrongs does not make a right. Rebecca held her ground. Let him do whatever he wants to say. Let him say what he wants to say. A time is coming when God will respond to him. And that was what happened to Isaac. Beloved, you have been fighting this man all this while. What has happened? You have been responding to everything he says. What has happened? Nothing. But Rebecca kept her cool. And what happened? When it was the appropriate time, what happened? God himself was the one who responded to Isaac. You see, that one entered Isaac more than if Rebecca had spoken. If Rebecca had spoken, Isaac would say, I know you will say that. I know that is the way you have been doing. So, I lied, and so I will continue. But you see, when God himself dealt with Isaac personally, what happened? He sobered him. Beloved, this morning, there are several things in this text, but this one just came in. But we need to understand our response to issues. Very, very vital. Very, very important. Sometimes when our blood is high, we need to pray God to cool it down. So that I can respond to situation at the appropriate time. It's not all things that I respond to. It's not all things I try to fight for myself. Let God fight for you. I pray for all our mothers who are going through issues and who are being afflicted one way or the other by the attitude or the characters of their husband. The Lord will respond for you. Amen. The Lord will fight your battle. Amen. The Lord will settle the matter. Amen. In the name of Jesus. And so we found Isaac saying, because his thought was what made him to leave, you know, to move to Gerar. His thought was what made him to go and look for help from a heathen king. His thought again now got him in trouble. To look at his wife in the face and say, Rebecca, you are not my wife. You are my sister. That was half truth anyway. But he was not telling the truth. I wonder why will Isaac get to that point? You know, if you go back to Genesis 24, you remember that when the brothers and the family of Rebecca, you know, when Eliezer, you know, came to the house, the family called Rebecca and said, Rebecca, are you ready to go with him? She said, yes, even when she has not seen the man. Yet this is the man that she has not now seen. And the man said, no, I don't know you. It's a serious matter. I pray our fathers will not deny our mothers. Neither our mothers will they deny their husbands. In the name of Jesus. The thing that will make us deny each other, the Lord will not allow it in our homes. In the name of Jesus Christ. Now we see the plan of God was to bring him up to speed. To bring Isaac up to speed about the things that he needed to do in his life. So that he can be considered as a man was also doing the right things. So what are the things, the right things that God was trying to highlight to Isaac in Genesis 26? The first one is that God was trying to highlight to Isaac that trusting me is the right thing. That's the first right thing that God was trying to mirror to Isaac. And that is what God is also mirroring to you and I this morning. Trusting God is the right thing for us. Trust me because you are a covenant child. In Isaiah 49 verse 15, he said, can a mother forget the baby at her breast and have no compassion on the child she has born? Though she may forget, he said, I will not forget you. That's why we need to trust him. So the right thing for us in this time, where things are hard, where there's famine in the land, where there are difficulties and issues that we are battling with day and night, God is saying, the right thing for you, my son, my daughter, trust me. Trust me.
Trust me. Because what? Because you are my child. If your earthly mother forgets you, I will not forget you. That is God speaking. That is the covenant relationship that we have with God. That God will never forget us. That if God could take care of the ants on the ground, then God will take care of us. There was a day we were eating on the table and some crunches were falling down from Oba's food. And then he was saying, who will now take this? I said, leave it. Don't worry about it. Ants will come and take it. That is God using you to provide for them. It looks so simple, but that's the truth. That's the truth. Ants, they don't walk. Ants, they don't sow. But yet, it is your own crumb that falls from the table that they will get to eat. So if God can make sure that when you are eating, some of the crunches will fall down so that the ants can eat, then God will take care of me. God will take care of you. So God was highlighting to Isaac, in this time, trust me. That's the first thing, the first right thing that God was highlighting to Isaac. The second right thing that God was highlighting to Isaac was the issue that what turn to God, not man, is the right thing to do. Isaac was looking to what? He was looking to Abimelech. Now, Abimelech was a king in the land of the Philistines. Remember in Genesis 20, his father made the same mistake of going to another Abimelech. The word Abimelech is a title. It's not the name of the king, but it's a title. So it's possible that it was the father of this particular one that Isaac was interacting with that met Abraham. So we'll see that Isaac was trying to look for help from a man. But listen to what the scripture says in Psalm 118, verse 8 and 9, in the Message translation. He said, far better to take refuge in God than trust in people. Far better to take refuge in God than trust celebrities. That's what the scripture says. That trust in me. So Isaac was looking, you know, to for help from people that we consider as celebrities. People who he thought that can help him. But yet, the Bible says it is far better to take refuge in God. Because sometimes a man can help you and tomorrow he will stand on the podium somewhere and tell you, if not us, you know, if not us, he cannot be. If not us, he cannot be. They will say it. But you see, it is God who blesses you. It is God who honors you. It is God who does so much great things for you and never comes back and say, you must do this for me. No. God Almighty. So God was highlighting to Isaac, trust me, is the right thing to do. The third thing that God was highlighting to Isaac was that telling the truth is the right thing to do. That's the crux of our message this morning. Telling the truth is the right thing to do. Truth is an accurate presentation of fact. That's what truth is. So anything that is not captured in accurate presentation of the fact, then it is not true. Therefore, in Ephesians 4:25, he says, therefore, laying aside falsehood, speak truth, each one of you with his neighbor, for we are members of one another. Now, if we look at these three things that God was highlighting to Isaac, I'm sure many of us will not have problem with the first one, to trust God. Many of us will not have issues with the second one, to turn to God. But many are having issues in what? In telling the truth. When JSM newly came, a sister was sharing with us, she was driving on Ikorodu Road. And all of a sudden, a church member drove past her. And this church member happened to be a prominent leader in the church. And so in a bit to say, okay, I saw you. So she picked her phone and then, you know, dialed this person's number. And then, you know, just called. And then the person picked. Hello, how are you? Please, where are you? And the person said, I'm in Shomolu. while he was right there on what? On Ikorodu Road. Yes, we are connecting now, ba? So many people don't have issues with trusting God. Many don't have issues with turning to God, but many people have issues of what? Telling the truth. That's the issue that God Almighty is highlighting to us this morning. You know, many times we cook up issues. We say, you know, I wasn't feeling fine. That's why I'm not in the office. But it's not that you are not feeling fine. You wanted to do another business somewhere, so you left that business. Instead of going to office, you know, I'm not feeling fine. You know, if God were to allow some sickness to come upon us, many of us would be carrying many things. But God is so merciful. You say, I'm not feeling fine. And then, you know, God will say, I forgive you this time again. But see, it's an issue. Sometimes, you know, we'll be in the office. Maybe your boss, you know, doesn't want to speak to somebody and say, you know, tell the person that not, and then you just speak to the phone. He's not here right now, you know, to take his call, but right there he's there. God help you if you have some small children who are very fantastic. You tell the child, oh, tell the person I'm not around. The child picks the phone and says, oh, my daddy said I should tell you that he's not around, though he's in the room. And then, you know, but you see, those are issues. Those are issues. Sometimes we exaggerate some things. Sometimes we bend the truth by cheating in our incomes or in our taxes or even our tithes. You know, things are very hard today. Many people are no longer faithful in their tithe. And we can have many reasons why we're not faithful in our tithe. Some people cheat in exams, in tests, and they give excuses. Everybody is doing it anyway. Everybody is doing it. So why? Why can't I do it as well? Parents even buy results for their children. You know, they buy results for their children and you know, they celebrate. Holy, you know, praise the Lord. The Lord has done it. Who did it? So, the Bible is brutally honest in exposing the failures of some of the great men and women of faith. Thank God that the scripture was given to us and is open, that you can see that in the life of each of even the patriarchs that we are reading about day and night, the scripture was very plain and very brutal to expose to us the areas where they are falling so that you and I will not fall there. That's why Paul in 2 Corinthians chapter 6 verse 10 was saying all these things happened to them as an example for us so that we in this generation will not fall into what they fell into. And so we have this particular matter. So in the life of Isaac has become deceptive. Truth has died with Isaac. And so a reflection of many of us today that truth has died in the life of many people. Why do we sometimes lie? Or why do we sometimes not tell the truth? Why is it that sometimes we find ourselves on the table of wrongness? Maybe we want to save our face. And sometimes maybe we want to please some people. In the case of Isaac was looking for diplomatic favor. You know, diplomatic favor with the king of Gerar. You know, It is an in thing to work with people who are in high places. But you see, if you are working with people in high places and you are living a life of falsehood, you have failed. So Isaac was looking for diplomatic favor, and then in the process, truth died inside of him. Isaac got to the extent that he denied his wife. He denied his wife, not even publicly, openly, he denied her. If it was not the patience of God, maybe Isaac would have been the first patriarch that got a divorce. You know, the next thing would have been that Rebecca comes home and says, so I'm going back to Syria. You know, she was a Syrian. I'm going back to Syria. Sorry. That you can tell people that I'm not your wife. Oh, it's okay. Let everybody just go. But thank God for the patience of Rebecca. She still loved him. She still served him. She still followed him until they eventually died. So, Rebecca gave up so much, but Isaac was not willing to give up so much in his own life. Now, finally, what doing the right things will do for us. Number one, rightness will prevent reproach. Rightness, when we do the right thing, it will prevent reproach. And that's what we saw in the life of Isaac. Who was the one that caught Isaac? It was the king. The Bible says that the king was looking through his window and then he saw Isaac kissing or caressing his wife. What he could not do in the public, he was doing in the secret. You know, Isaac lived so deceitfully that if you read through the book of Genesis 26, his sons were not mentioned. Have you observed that? His sons, Jacob and Esau, and as of this time they have given birth to them, the children were already 40 years old. So I imagine that Isaac went into Gerar like a single man. And Jacob, Esau were like servants. And Rebekah was like a maid in the house. So in the public, he will move like a single man. And sometimes the people will be looking at him and say, look at this fine man. Even though he was a married man. You know, may God deliver some fathers who are living as if they are not married. Deceiving innocent young people. Making innocent young people to begin to pray. And then they pray, and then later on they found out that this one has already 4 children somewhere. That was what Isaac was living. Because you cannot imagine, why would the people be the one that will come and ask him, excuse me, sir, who is this lady? That means that in the public, Isaac lived as if he was a single man. He didn't want anything to do with his family, all because of diplomatic favor. May God deliver us. But you see, what was the reproach here? The reproach was that what? It was an unbeliever that now said, Isaac, come here. Why did you lie to us? I imagine how Isaac would feel that day. That it was an unbeliever that is now telling you that you are a liar. Beloved, doing the right thing will prevent reproach. Whatsoever area of our life, whatsoever environment that we find ourselves, please do the right thing so that there won't be reproach to us. That there won't be reproach, not only to us, but even to the name of God. Sometimes when you have, you know, your car and you have all these banners or all these stickers on them, the blood of Jesus, Jesus loves you, and you did something, and somebody will look and say, even the people who carry the blood of Jesus are doing this. So reproach is a reproach for an unbeliever to be questioning the integrity of people who are called the redeemed. Is a reproach for people who are out there, who are unbelievers, to look at us and say, who do you think you are? When after all, your hands have been soiled in all kinds of evil. When of course you are the one who will change the figure. When of course you are the one who will be at the helm of affairs and things will go bad. It's a reproach, not only to you, but to the church of God and to the cross that brought salvation to us. It was a reproach for Isaac, for the hidden king to call him to order. It was Abimelech who called Isaac to order and said, why? Why did you lie to us? Why did you jeopardize the purity of your wife? Because if somebody had gone into Rebekah, they would have defiled her and destroyed the purity of Rebekah. All because of your lies. Beloved, this morning, God is asking you and I that reproach will come to anyone who decides to do things in the wrong way. And you see, sometimes God may be managing it for you and thinking you are going to what repent. When you refuse to repent, the public one is the shameful one. For Isaac, the king called him to order. And said, even us as people, Philistines will not do what you did. Imagine that. Philistines will not do what I'm doing as a covenant child. Then something is wrong. Beloved, this morning, rightness will prevent reproach. So as we go this week, please, let's do the right thing. No matter how the situation is in the country, please don't venture into trying to do anything in the wrong way in order to gain something. Because the reproach will be too bad. Sometimes when I watch on the television, our military men who are sworn to protect the integrity of Nigeria, men who have high rank on their shoulders, are being handcuffed or are being led by EFCC. It's a shameful reproach. He's a military man. Imagine a major general or a brigadier being harassed by this small EFCC boy. Tell him, move here, go here. Something that if he had lived well, something that they would never have done to him. It's a reproach if somebody does things that are not right. The second thing that doing the right thing will do is that what? Rightness will protect the righteous. Look at what Abimelech eventually said in verse 11. So Abimelech gave order to all the people. Anyone who harmed this man or his wife shall surely be put to death. Look at the protection that Isaac was jeopardizing, was throwing away. Even before Abimelech knew about this matter, Isaac was under a covenant of God's protection. God's protection was upon him, but immediately he ventured into those things, he's exposed. He exposes himself. But you see, when we do the right thing, we are protected. There's a shield of God's covering over our life. Anywhere we go, in whatever circumstances we find ourselves, God Almighty will do what? Will protect us. He will shield us. He will make way for us. Even when they want to harass us, his shield of protection will come over our life. And we'll find our way through. The last thing that rightness will do for us, rightness will push you to the next level. In the case of Isaac, the breakthrough did not come until he settled matter of doing things the right way. That's why we read verse 12. And the first word, the adverb in verse 12, the first word there was, and then. He said, and then Isaac sowed in the land. And then he reaped, and then the man became prosper. The adverb then is a connection between all the things that have been happening from verse 1. That because Isaac was living in wrongness and was not doing things the right way, there seems to be a stalemate in his life. And then when he now repented, he was confronted, and then he saw himself. What happened? The Bible says, and then Isaac prospered. There's a connection. That rightness will push us into what? Into the next level of our life. So are you trusting God for unusual breakthrough? The unusual breakthrough comes when we decide to do it the right way. Let me end with this word. It is better ultimately to succeed with truth than to temporarily succeed with lies. So if you have been succeeding with lies, a day is coming when the bubbles will burst. Thomas Aquinas says that as a matter of honor, one man owes it to another to manifest the truth. Beloved, our country is where we are today because many things are no longer being done the right way. And so this morning, God is calling our attention to this matter. What are you going to do with it? What am I going to do about it? God said, we must do it the right way. Please, let's close our eyes and let's commit ourselves into the hands of God. That God, you will forgive me. There's so many wrong things that I've done. There's so many wrong things I've said. There's so many wrong attitudes that I've put up. Lord, will you forgive me? That's our prayer. That's the first prayer we're praying this morning. We're asking God that, Lord, you will have mercy upon us. There's so many wrong things that we have said, that we have done, that we have been involved in. Will we just say, God, please have mercy upon us. Please have mercy upon us. Please have mercy upon us. This is very, very important. That God wants us to repent of our wrongness. Have you been doing things wrong at home? You have been doing things wrong with your husband. You have been doing things wrong with your wife. This is the time to make amends, to say, God, I am sorry. Like Isaac, you have been denying yourself, your wife. Like Isaac, you have been denying your wife. Wife, you have been denying your husband. God Almighty is saying, no, those things are wrong. You cannot continue in that wrongness and think that unusual breakthrough will come. This is the time to repent. This is the time to say, Lord, we are sorry. Are you an officer in one department or the other? You have been doing things wrongly. Why not say, God, we are sorry. We are sorry. I have contributed to the problem of Nigeria. When I drive roughly, when I say things I ought not to say, I contributed to the corruption in Nigeria. When I do not do things rightly in my office, in my home, when I do not do things rightly the way God wants it to be done, Lord, I am sorry. Please, will you pray this morning and ask God to forgive us? Will you ask God Almighty to have mercy upon us this morning? In the name of Jesus, Lord, have mercy upon us. In the name of Jesus. This morning, I have a lady in my heart. Pastor Dario will come and pray for us. Are you here this morning? Please, all eyes closed. There are issues at home. Just like in the case of Isaac. Issues at home. The home is no longer what it ought to be because of the way you have presented yourself. You have been responding to your husband. You have been responding and things have become heated up. And things are no longer settled. But God Almighty this morning is saying, I want to respond on your behalf. Are you here this morning? We want to pray for you. We want to ask God Almighty to intervene in that situation at home, in your relationship at home, in your relationship at work. God is about to intervene. We want to pray for somebody this morning. If you're in that category, I would like you to stand up. Please, all eyes closed. It's not time for you to look at anybody. We are making commitments to God. Even in the light of this message, there's something you want God to do in your life. We want to ask Pastor Dari to come and pray for us. Thank you, ma. Is there any other person? You are making one commitment or the other this morning. Thank you, sir. Thank you. Is there any other person? You want to do things the right way. We are making a new commitment to God and say, God, here am I. I cannot help myself, but you will help me. You will. Thank you. Thank you. Any other person?
Grace, grace, God's grace, grace that's with pardon and cleanse within. The opportunity for you to join those who are standing. That we pardon and cleanse. That grace is here this morning to pardon and to cleanse us. Your word says if we say we have no sin, we are still compounding the issues by telling more lies. Lord, we have seen ourselves in the mirror of your word, and we come before you that you will show us mercy, that you will forgive us in the name of Jesus. Many of us, we have done wrongs on purpose, that we even knew that what we wanted to do was wrong, but we went ahead for one reason or the other, and we did it. Father, we ask this morning that you will show us mercy and forgive us in the name of Jesus. Lord, for our brothers and sisters that are standing before you. We receive grace for them because you have not stood here, Lord, even to condemn anybody. Like Jesus Christ said to that woman, that is there no one who condemns you? And she said, no one. He said, neither do I also condemn you, but go and sin no more. Father, the grace to do that which is right at all time, we receive for each of these ones in the name of Jesus. And for all of us, O God, that are sitting down, that in our hearts we are making one resolution or the other, the grace to do what is right at all times we receive in the name of Jesus. Father, we pray, O God, for our brothers that are standing and our sisters. Lord, if there is any issue that is beyond their power at home, that they cannot handle by themselves, we pray, O God Almighty, that your mercy will speak for them, that you will vigorously defend their cause in the name of Jesus. Father, we thank you for hearing us. O Lord, our God, we pray for our nations, that, Lord, you will help our leaders to do what is right at all times in the name of Jesus. That we will not just be wasting your resources, we will no longer be wasting life, O God, unnecessarily in this nation by doing what is wrong. But, Lord, henceforth, Lord, a work will be carried out in this nation that will make every heart to want to do what is right, always in the name of Jesus Christ. Father, we pray that you will make every one of us that has listened to your word this morning to be an agent of transformation. Make us an agent of light in the name of Jesus. Thank you, everlasting Father. Lord, we pray for your servant that your hand will continue to be mighty upon him. In Jesus' mighty name, we have prayed.